بسم الله الرحمن بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسولنا الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. وبعد، إن شاء الله تعالى, we have Sheikh Khalid Radadi, and we're going to translate for the Sheikh in relation to what is going on in the current affair of the virus of coronavirus, and we will hear from Ahl al-Ilm, the people of knowledge, what they have to say in relation to that. فليتفضل مشكورا يا شيخنا.
بسم الله، إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين ومن تبعهم أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
أما بعد، فيطيب لي في هذا اللقاء معكم أيها الإخوة أن نلتقي لنتذاكر سويا في هذا الظرف العصيب وهذا الوقت وهذه الجائحة التي نزلت بالمسلمين. نسأل الله عز وجل أن يعجل بكشف الغمة وزوال البلاء عن المسلمين. يطيب لي أن أتحدث معكم. تفضل.
The Sheikh Hafidhullah, he went on to, he began with saying, with the start with the Bismillah, and the Sheikh began to with khutbah tahajjah, with sending peace and blessings, praising Allah, and sending peace and blessings upon his messenger, which is well known to us. And then he went on to end with sending more praise and blessings upon our messenger and those who follow their way and his companions. And then he began with saying, Assalamu alaikum. And what we responded, Wa alaikum salam. And the Sheikh said, we're going to have reminders about this tremendous catastrophe that it has and the disaster that has befallen the Muslims. And we will discuss about that subject matter. Now, the football next quarter.
يطيب لي أن أتذاكر وأذكر نفسي أولا ثم السامعين بما ينبغي علينا أن نتأمله وأن نقف معه في هذا الظرف العصيب.
The Sheikh went on to say that we're going to talk about, he said, this the reminders we want to give to the people who are listening today, our obligation towards this virus, and what is our position in relation to doing dealing with it. Naam, tafadhal.
نعم نقول ها هنا بأن على المسلم أن يتذكر أن الخير والشر بقدر. قال تعالى إنا كل شيء خلقناه بقدر، وأن الله وحده هو النافع والضار، ولا يكون شيء إلا بعلمه وأمره تبارك وتعالى، وله الحكمة البالغة بتقديره، وأن الله تعالى يبتلي عباده ويمتحنهم بالشر كما يبتليهم بالخير، وأن المراد من ذلك كله الرجوع إلى الله تعالى. قال تعالى وبلوناهم بالحسنات والسيئات لعلهم يرجعون. فقال تعالى فلولا إذ جاءهم بأسنا تضرعوا ولكن قست قلوبهم وزين لهم الشيطان ما كانوا يعملون.
The Sheikh Hafidhullah, he went on to say that the first thing is that we must understand is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tests his creation so that everything is under his decree, that which is good and that which is evil. Just as Allah ta'ala mentions in the Quran that every single thing he creates is with a due estimation. It has a due estimation to it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the one who causes the harm, he brings it about, and is based out of his knowledge and his infinite wisdom. And he likes to test his servants with trials that are in that which is good and that which is evil. As Allah Ta'ala mentions in the Quran, verily we will test them with a trial with that which is good and that which is evil. And Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala also mentions thereafter that the servants are rejectionary towards Allah's reminder and ungrateful. So Allah puts them to trial. Naam, tafaddal mashkura.
ولنعلم أن الإسلام أمر المسلم بالتوكل على الله في جميع أموره. قال تعالى وعلى الله فتوكلوا إن كنتم مؤمنين. وقال تعالى ومن يتوكل على الله فهو حسبه. فلا يخاف المسلم إلا من الله. كل هذا مع أخذه بالأسباب المباحة أو الواجبة شرعا دون إيذاء أو تخويف للآخرين، كتخويف بتلك الأخبار السيئة عن هذه الأمراض والشائعات المكذوبة دون أدنى تبين أو تكذب. وفي ذلك يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا عدوى ولا طيرة. ويعجبني الفأل. قالوا وما الفأل يا رسول الله؟ قال الكلمة الطيبة أو الحسنة. أخرجه أبو داود والترمذي وهو حديث صحيح. نعم.
The Sheikh Hafidhullah, he went on to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we have been ordered by him with placing our tawakkul, our reliance upon him alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he mentions a couple of ayahs in that regard, where Allah ta'ala mentions and upon Allah, let the believers place their trust and reliance. And so therefore, because of that, taqwa, the fear and the God consciousness, being aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fearing Him and doing what He commands and staying away from what He prohibits, is the attitude of the believer, that we put our sole reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And upon Allah is where the believers place their trust. And that is inclusive to complete reliance on Allah and seizing the means around you for things to occur and protect yourself. That this is what we must be combined with, fearing Allah only and seizing the means around us to achieve what must be done. And not to fall victim to the rumors that's being spread out there, of the various rumors that's coming from various people, but rather we leave that. And he said, in this regard, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that there is no contagious disease, nor is there no omen. And that this, we must understand in this hadith, when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this, that he mentioned whether we are optimistic, whether we must be optimistic and seek the good. And this is the statement of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the meaning of his statement, alayhi salatu wasalam, as I believe he said, was narrated by the Tirmidhi and the Tabarani. I think he also mentioned narrated this. Now, tafaddal mashkur.
المرض والشفاء بيد الله عز وجل. قال تعالى: وإذا مرضت فهو يشفين. والتداوي والعلاج ما هو إلا أخذ بالأسباب التي أودعها الله تعالى في الكون، وهو أمر مشروع لا يتعارض مع قضاء الله وقدره.
Now, the Sheikh Hafidhullah went on to say that the healing and curing of individuals from this disease or any disease is in the hands of Allah. And no one has control over that reality except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran in relation to Ibrahim, that when you're sick, Allah will heal me. That when you're sick, Allah will heal me. That when I'm sick, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will heal me. وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينِ. That when I am sick, Allah is the only one that will heal me. And the Sheikh says this is the requirement, is that we understand there's no one who has the ability to spread a contagious disease but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He's the only one who can heal from it. نعم تفضل مشكورا.
وفي هذا البلاء الذي اجتاح العالم كله يتأمل المسلم ويتذكر حينئذ أن الإنسان ضعيف، ومهما ظن البشر أنهم تقدموا واكتشفوا وعرفوا، فإن الحقيقة كما قال الله تعالى: وخلق الإنسان ضعيفا. وقال تعالى: يا أيها الناس أنتم الفقراء إلى الله والله هو الغني الحميد. يتذكر المسلم أنه لا يكشف الضر إلا الله سبحانه وتعالى. قال تعالى: وإن يمسسك الله بضر فلا كاشف له إلا هو، وإن يمسسك بخير فهو على كل شيء قدير. وقال تعالى: أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء ويجعلكم خلفاء الأرض إله مع الله قليلا ما تذكرون. نعم.
The Sheikh Hafidhullah, he went on to mention that being tested in trials and tribulations is things that Allah brings about to the human being to teach him lessons and to learn from it. And from amongst the lessons is that you learn the full capability of Allah and the weakness of ourselves. The full capability of Allah and the weakness of ourselves and the dire need that we have for Allah. He says, Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا, that mankind has been created, or mankind was created weak. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran that you are impoverished to Allah, and Allah is worthy of all, is free of all needs and worthy of all praise. And so we are in constant need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for He is the only one who can remove us from whatever harm that He decrees for us. As Allah ta'ala says in the Quran, that there's no one to remove the harm except for Allah. And He, Allah Ta'ala, mentions that He's Mujibu Muttarra, that He's the one who responds to the one in dire need and dire strait when he's in his situation. And if Allah removes you from that same situation, that He is the one who has full capability and power over everything. Naam, tafaddal mashkura.
نعم. فعلى المسلم بذل الأسباب الشرعية والكونية للنجاة من المصائب والبلاء. ومن أهم الأسباب الشرعية التوكل الصادق على الله عز وجل. وكذلك من الأسباب الشرعية الإصلاح والتوبة ورد المظالم وأداء الحقوق والاستغفار والإكثار من الصدقات والدعاء والأعمال الصالحات. قال تعالى: وما كان الله ليعذبهم وأنت فيهم، وما كان الله معذبهم وهم يستغفرون. ومنه قوله تعالى: وما كان ربك ليهلك القرى بظلم وأهلها مصلحون. وفي الحديث الصحيح قوله عليه الصلاة والسلام في وصيته لابن عباس: احفظ الله احفظ الله تجده تجاهك. ويتذكر المسلم أنه ما نزل بلاء إلا بذنب ولا رفع إلا بتوبة. نعم.
The Sheikh حفظه الله, he says it's very important that we work by the means that surround us and put our best effort to work by the means that Allah has given us, the legislative means. And from amongst the legislative means that we must work by is having true determination and reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that we must make a lot of supplication to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask Allah's aid and His support and seek His forgiveness and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are from the legislative means that Allah has given us. As Allah ta'ala mentions in the Quran, that it is not that He will not punish you as long as you, Muhammad, is amongst them, and He will not punish them as long as they seek His forgiveness. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put us to trial, so that we may establish this repentance and returning back and supplicating and using the legislative means by being kind to others and doing good to others from amongst the creation. All of these are legislative means for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us and preserve us. And as comes in the hadith of Ibn Abbas, when he was riding behind the Messenger of Allah on his riding beast, and the Messenger turned to him and said, احفظ الله, preserve Allah, meaning preserve the rights that Allah obligated upon you, or the rights of Allah over you, and what He legislated upon you, preserve Allah, and Allah will preserve you, and you will find Allah before you and aiding you. So this is the thing that is required of us, is that we work by what we've been commanded, by what Allah has legislated, and respond to that, and that's the means to get Allah to preserve us and protect us. These are the legislative means. Likewise, we must understand, because of this, that never does a trial descend except because of a sin. Never does a trial descend upon anyone except it's because of some sin. And never will it ever be raised up from anyone except through repentance. نعم تفضل مشكورا يا شيخ.
ومن المهم أن يتحصن المسلم دائما ويكثر من ذلك في حال المصائب والفتن, أن يتحصن بالأوراد الشرعية والأدعية المأثورة لنفسه وأهله. وقد ثبت جملة منها في التحصين والحفظ, ومن ذلك أذكار الصباح والمساء. منه قوله في الحديث الصحيح: بسم الله الذي لا يضر مع اسمه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء وهو السميع العليم ثلاثا, وأعوذ بكلمات الله التامات من شر ما خلق ثلاثا, وقراءة المعوذتين وآية الكرسي. ومنه قراءة الآيتين من آخر سورة البقرة كل ليلة. وكذلك أدعية الخروج من البيت ونزول المنزل وعند إرادة النوم. ومنه صلاة 4 ركعات أول النهار, والمواظبة على الصلوات المفروضة في وقتها. وكذلك أدعية الكرب والأدعية الواردة في عفو النفس والتعوذ من البلاء وسيء الأسقام. وكذلك الرقية الشرعية. ويرجع إلى هذا إلى كتابين مختصرين مفيدين. الكتاب الأول صحيح الكلم الطيب للشيخ الألباني رحمه الله, والكتاب الثاني حصن المسلم للشيخ القحطاني رحمه الله, وفيهما تفصيل لما ذكر.
Now, the Sheikh Hafidhullah, he went on to say, from amongst the legislative means to protect yourself is to seize the protections of fortitude, the hidden protections of fortitude that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, that we must seize those things from the legislative supplications that come in the book of Allah and the sunnah of his messenger. From amongst them is the morning and evening supplication. And from amongst them is many other supplication that has come in the sunnah. And he mentioned from them is the hadith where the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that whoever says three times in the morning and the evening, in the morning and the evening, says Bismillah ladhi la yadurru ma'ahu shay'un fil ardi wa la fis samaa' wa huwa as-sami'ul 'aleem. In the name of Allah, who the one who with the mentioning of his name nothing is harmed, not in the heavens nor in the earth, and he is the all-hearing and the all-knowing. Saying this supplication three times will protect you from things harming you. Saying the supplication of I seek refuge of Allah from the evil things that he has created. From the evil things that he has created. And also saying the mu'awwadhatayn, Qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq, and chapter called Qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq and Qul a'udhu bi rabbin nas. Saying these two surahs in the morning and the evening is a means to protect yourself. He said also from the means to protect ourselves is saying the supplications that Allah Ta'ala has legislated that protects you from various diseases, like the supplication saying to Allah, I seek refuge with you from leprosy, from madness, from disease that ripped the bodies apart, and from evil asam, from evil diseases. Also from the things that gives protection is saying, praying four raka'at in the morning time. Praying four raka'at in the morning time around duha time. Saying praying four raka'at, this is a means of protection. Also doing any ruqya shar'iyya, any legislative incantation that's been established in the book of Allah and the sunnah of his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From amongst the things that will protect is preserving your five prayers at their proper time. These are the things that help brings protection to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Making a supplication when you leave out your, before leaving out the house and when entering the home. He also mentioned a supplication before going to bed. And he also mentioned reciting the last ayahs of Surah Al-Baqarah, that these, and ayatul kursi, that these things are means of supplication that's been established and many others that is a means of protection for us. And you can find all of these supplications in the book, alhamdulillah, that was written, two specific books he mentioned. The book written by, or explained, written by Ibn Taymiyyah, but with the explanation of Sheikh al-Albani of Sahih al-Kalimat al-Tayyib, the corrections of the book, The Goodly Word, by Ibn Taymiyyah, with Sheikh al-Albani's corrections to it. And he said also the book that's written by al-Qahtani, Qahisn al-Muslim, which is, alhamdulillah, both of these books, as far as I know, is translated and available for the English-speaking Muslim, and which is the fortitude of the Muslim that we have in that black book, that you can find all of these supplications in them, and we should seize these means of protection so that we can protect ourselves. Now, فَلْيَتَفَضُّ مَشْكُورٍ يَا شَيْخِ
الْإِسْلَامُ دِينُ الْكَمَالِ وَالْجَمَالِ وَالنَّبَاطَةِ لِذَلِكَ أَمَرَ الْإِسْلَامُ بِالْغُسْلِ وَالتَّطَهُّرِ مِنَ الْأَوْسَاخِ وَالْأَدْرَانِ التي هي مرتع للأمراض وسبب في نقلها وانتشارها. قال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا قمتم إلى الصلاة فاغسلوا وجوهكم وأيديكم إلى المرافق وامسحوا برؤوسكم وأرجلكم إلى الكعبين وإن كنتم جنبا فطهروا، الآية. وقال تعالى: إن الله يحب التوابين ويحب المتطهرين. وفي صحيح البخاري عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: حق على كل مسلم أن يغتسل في كل 7 أيام يوما يغسل فيه رأسه وجسده. وفي صحيح مسلم عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: الطهور شطر الإيمان، أي تجعل النظافة والتطهر نصف الإيمان، نصف الإيمان. وكذلك فإن الإسلام قد أمر بنظافة الفم والأسنان، حيث شرع لنا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سنة السواك، وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: لولا أن أشق على أمتي لأمرتهم بالسواك عند كل وضوء. والشريعة أمرت بحفظ الأطعمة ونظافتها. وفي صحيح مسلم عن جابر بن عبد الله رضي الله عنهما قال: سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: غطوا الإناء وأوكئوا السقاء. فإن في السنة ليلة ينزل فيها وباء لا يمر بإناء ليس عليه غطاء أو سقاء ليس عليه وكاء إلا ونزل فيه من ذلك الوباء. والأدلة من الآيات والأحاديث الدالة على مشروعية النظافة والتطهر كثيرة جدا، وفيها وقاية بإذن الله من كثير من الأمراض والفيروسات والأوبئة المنتشرة. نعم.
The Sheikh Hafidhullah, he went on to explain that Islam, the religion of Islam, is a religion that is complete and it's perfect and it's a purity. For that reason, it commands us with purification and cleanliness under all circumstances. As Allah Ta'ala mentions in the Quran, as he mentioned, O you who believe, that when you intend to stand for the prayer, then let you wash your hands, your face, and your hands to your elbows, and wash your feet to your ankles. That this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has established the importance of purification and cleanliness. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, indeed Allah loves those who purify themselves. And from amongst the sunnahs of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the believer is the command by the Prophet to make ghusl every 7 days on the day of Jumu'ah. All of this is a means of cleanliness. Or the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said purification is half of Iman. Purification is half of Iman. So this shows the seriousness of purification in the religion of Allah, the religion that is perfect and complete and whole and covers all aspects of life. And this is the reason why the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered us to brush our teeth with the sawak, to clean our teeth before performing the five prayers with the miswak, as we say, or the tooth cleaner stick, and like this. And also, Islam has encouraged us to preserve the cleanliness of our food that we eat and keeping it protected and guarded. As the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had commanded that we should cover our containers of food at night, for verily there's a disease that goes through the night, and it don't touch food that is covered. It doesn't touch the food that is covered. He says, so here all of this is showing us the legislation of purification and cleanliness and how Islam has commanded us to stay purified and to stay clean. And all of these are means of protecting ourselves from any diseases, any plague that befalls us. Walhamdulillah. Tafadhal mashkuran.
وعلى المسلم أن يتخذ كما تقدم يتخذ الأسباب المشروعة الذي ذكرناه فيما سبق من أسباب الشرعية والكونية بعضها، عليه أن يتخذ الأسباب، ومن اتخاذ الأسباب أن يسمع ويطيع للأوامر الصادرة في هذا الصدر، فإن فيه مصلحة عامة للناس جميعا، يسمع ويطيع هذه الأوامر ولا يخالف، فعليه أن ينفذ هذه الأوامر التي فيها وقاية وحماية للناس حتى لا يتفشى هذا المرض ويعدي الناس ويلحق بهم ضررا كبيرا. ومجموع النصوص الشرعية تشير إلى وجوب اجتناب الأسباب المؤدية إلى انتقال العدوى، وقد قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بشأن الطاعون وهو مرض معدي، إذا سمعتم به بأرض فلا تقدموا عليه، وإذا وقع بأرض وأنتم بها فلا تخرجوا فرارا منه، أخرجه البخاري ومسلم. وقد فهم هذا المعنى أمير المؤمنين عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه عندما أراد دخول الشام ومعه كبار الصحابة، وقد استشر الطاعون فيها ومات الآلاف، حتى إنه قيل مات في طاعون عمواس 25,000. قال فأخذ عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه بالأسباب والحذر والحيطة، ورجع من معه إلى المدينة ولم يدخل الشام، وهذا ما يعرف اليوم بالحجر الصحي، ويدل على هذا قوله عليه الصلاة والسلام في الحديث الذي أخرجه البخاري ومسلم: لا يورد ممرض على مصح. ونهى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كذلك صاحب الإبل المراض أن يوردها على صاحب الإبل الصحاح. وقوله عليه الصلاة والسلام أيضا: فر من المجنون فرارك من الأسد. وهذه دعوة إلى التنفير من الاقتراب من صاحب المرض المعدي، وذلك تجنبا لسببه لعدم التعرض لأسباب العدوى. وقد سلك الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم الأسباب المؤدية لعدم انتقال العدوى نتيجة الأمراض المعدية. وقد أخرج مسلم في صحيحه من حديث عمرو بن الشريد عن أبيه قال: كان في وفد ثقيف رجل مجذوم، فأرسل إليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إنا قد بايعناك فارجع. وكانت البيعة تتم بطريق اللمس، وذلك بوضع اليد في اليد، ولا يوجد أوضح وأسرع من هذا النص. هذا نص صريح لتجنب التعامل مع المريض المصاب بمرض معدي. ثم إن في هذه الخطوات الشرعية مخاصرة للمرض ومنعا لانتقاله إلى الأصحاء ومنعا لخطره بإذن الله.
The Sheikh Hafizahullah, he went on to say that what is upon the Muslim based on what we have covered before already, referring to the avoidance of diseases. And those avoidance we've mentioned, that which is shar'iyya, or in relation to avoiding diseases, that which is in a legislative way, to what we've mentioned, and also that which is a tangible way of avoiding diseases. And from amongst those things that we must use to avoid diseases is adhering to the orders that has come down from the people who are specialists in relation to disease control. The things that they have given to us to avoid, these are the means around us that are good that we should seize. For all of that, it's nothing more than a hamaya. It's a means of protection for mankind. And this, the Messenger of Allah, in and of itself, he also talked about. So what they say is in congruence with what the Messenger of Allah has said. As he mentioned, that if you hear of a plague has in a particular land, do not go into that land. And if a plague befalls while you're in a land, then you must not leave from that land. He says, so here, this is the message of Allah telling us how to deal with these affairs when a plague occurs as a means to protect ourselves. If you're not in it, you go nowhere near it. You stay away from it. But if you're in the place where that plague takes place, you don't leave from that city or that area or that land, so as to protect you from infecting others. And he says also, we have another narration of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He was traveling with the major companions that were with him, the major scholars from amongst him, the major leaders amongst the companions, and the major people in which he sat in his council. That they were traveling to Sham, which is the Syrian area, and Jerusalem in those areas, right, in Jordan. They were traveling to this area on their way to go there. And they had reached them that there was a plague that had befallen the people there that killed thousands of people. And so Umar, radiallahu anhu, he sought consultation from those leaders from amongst the companions, and they decided, in following the hadith we mentioned, as one of the companions had informed them of the same hadith we just previously mentioned, and they decided to turn back to protect themselves. They decided to return back to protect themselves. And Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu anhu, had mentioned that, you know, he was fleeing from the decree of Allah to the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then also, the Shaykh mentioned there's other hadith from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We're talking about this issue of staying away from the places that have, or individuals that are sickly, who have diseases, that from a means to protect yourself from it is to avoid being around those individuals or people like that. And he mentioned a hadith of a camel that had a disease, incurable disease, and the animal came around it that did not, and it got sick. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that this was the decree of Allah, and that they should avoid doing that. Keep them away from one another. Because also in the hadith narrated by Bukhari, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you should flee from a disease, a person that has these diseases, like you flee from a lion. He says also in another hadith of the Messenger of Allah, that's also narrated by Bukhari, that there was a man who was majzoom, who had a disease that destroys and rips apart the body called juzam. And this juzam, or this person with this disease that was majzoom, what happened, he came to give pledge of allegiance to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Messenger of Allah stopped him at a distance and just raised the hand, and it showed that he accepted pledge of allegiance without going near him and shaking his hand. And he said, this is a clear-cut text of the Messenger of Allah staying away from a person with a disease so or plague to protect themselves from it. For we must work by the tangible means that is around us and follow the orders, those good orders and instructions that has come down for all of us to avoid being infected with these diseases. Naam. Falyatafaddal mashkuran ya shaykh.
نعم وعلى المسلم أن يتذكر أنه إذا كان يخاف على نفسه من هذا الوباء وحق له ذلك على اختلاف نسبة الوفيات في هذا الوباء يتذكر جيدا أن الموت آت به أو بغيره بهذا الوباء أو بغيره بنسبة 100%. فماذا عمل الإنسان لهذا وماذا قدم وبماذا استعد؟ ومن أصيب بهذا الوباء لا قدر الله أو بغيره فعليه الصبر والاحتساب وأن لا يخالط أحدا وأن يتبرع إلى الله زيادة على ما كان عليه من قبل وفيه وله أسوة بالأنبياء عليهم الصلاة والسلام. قال تعالى وأيوب إذ نادى ربه أني مسني الضر وأنت أرحم الراحمين فاستجبنا له فكشفنا ما به من ضر وآتيناه أهله ومثلهم معه رحمة من عندنا وذكرى للعابدين. وعليه أن يتذكر كذلك أن كل شيء هو بقضاء الله وقدره. وفي الحديث الصحيح قوله عليه الصلاة والسلام عجبا لأمر المؤمن إن أمره كله خير وليس ذلك لأحد إلا للمؤمن إن أصابته سراء شكر فكان خيرا له وإن أصابته ضراء صبر فكان خيرا له. أخرجه مسلم. وعليه أن يتفاعل خيرا ويحسن الظن بربه الرحيم الكريم فإن غالب الإصابات تشفى بإذن الله تعالى. وإذا قدر الله أنه لم يشفى فيرجى له حديث الطاعون شهادة لكل مسلم متفق عليه. ولا ريب أن هذا الوباء من الطواعين ويلحق بها. وثبت أن المرض عموما فيه كفارة للذنوب. عن أم المؤمنين عائشة رضي الله عنها أنها قالت سألت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الطاعون فقال كان عذابا يبعثه الله على من كان قبلكم فجعله الله رحمة للمؤمنين ما من عبد يكون في بلد فيكون فيه فيمكث لا يخرج صابرا محتسبا يعلم أنه لا يصيبه إلا ما كتب الله له إلا كان له أجر شهيد. أخرجه البخاري.
The Sheikh Hafizahullah, he went on to say that it is upon the Muslim to remind himself and to reflect and to be afraid of what's happening. For he has the right to do so, to be afraid. Rightfully so, he should be afraid. Death is going to come to all of us, whether it be from a plague or other than it. What is important is that we always strive to prepare for ourselves for death, with being patient, and with supplication, and with adherence to the commands of Allah and His Messenger. He says, this example was beautifully illustrated for us from the prophets and messengers, from the Anbiya. From amongst them is Prophet Ayyub, alayhi salatu salam, when he was afflicted with disease over his whole body. He turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and says, oh Allah, pray, I'm afflicted with a disastrous disease. And Allah ta'ala He asked Allah to heal him and to aid him. And Allah healed him from his disease. And Allah mentioned that he healed him and gave him a new family and gave him new wealth and changed things for him because of his turning to Allah. He says, in these times, whatever you used to do of obedience and worship, these are the times you should increase in more obedience. You should increase in more supplication. You should increase in more turning to Allah, as we see here, Prophet Ayyub, alayhi salatu wasalam. And that we understand that all of this that's occurring, bi qada' ilahi wa qadri, that is with the execution of Allah's decreeing and estimation of affairs. That this is how we understand. And so for that reason, we're patient. We meet it with patience and hoping for a reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in a hadith narrated in Sahih Muslim, when he described the affair of the believer, for the Messenger of Allah said, "Ajib an amr al mu'min." Amazing is the affair of the believer. And this amazement of and his affair, all of it is good. And this is for no one except for the believer. That if befalls him goodness, then he's grateful to Allah. If befalls him heart, and this is good for him. If befalls him evil, hardship, loss of life, death, difficulties, then he's patient. And this is good for him. And this is for no one except for the believer. So the Sheikh Hafizahullah, he mentioned that it is upon us to always strive to do the good and have to be optimistic. And understand this is all from the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and work by the means that is around us to achieve things, and work by the means that's around us for protection, as we've mentioned previous. Naam, tafaddal mashkura.
نذكر أنه لا يجوز للمسلم أن يتمنى الموت بسبب ضر أو بلاء نزل به، إنما عليه الصبر والاحتساب، وليعلم أن ابتلاء الله له بهذه الأمراض إنما هو تمحيص لذنوبه في الدنيا الفانية ورفعة لدرجاته في الآخرة الباقية. وما يصيب المسلم شيء إلا كفر الله به من خطاياه، وما عند الله خير وأبقى. وعن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال: عظم الجزاء مع عظم البلاء، وإن الله إذا حب قوما ابتلاهم، فمن رضي فله الرضا ومن سخط فله السخط. أخرجه ابن ماجه والترمذي، وهو حديث صحيح. وليتذكر أنه قد ابتلي بالأمراض القاتلة الأنبياء والمرسلون والصحابة وسلف الأمة رضوان الله عليهم، وصبروا وصابروا بما يعلمون من عظيم أجر الله تعالى. والله يبتلي عباده بالسراء والضراء. نسأل الله العفو والعافية التامة العامة، أن يرفع البلاء والغم عن هذه الأمة. الله خير حافظا وهو أرحم الراحمين. اللهم احفظنا بحفظك، واكنعنا برعايتك، واحرسنا بعينك التي لا تنام. اللهم ارفع عنا البلاء والوباء والغلاء عن المسلمين وعن المسلمين. اللهم لا تؤاخذنا بذنوبنا ولا بما فعله السفهاء منا. اللهم اجعلنا في حماك، واجعل عملنا في رضاك. إليك التجأنا وعليك توكلنا وإليك فوضنا أمورنا. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
آمين آمين آمين. جزاكم الله خيرا يا شيخ هذا. The Sheikh حفظه الله. We left off a hadith he mentioned previous, so we're going to mention that along with what he just said. He says also from amongst the affairs with these disasters and these plagues that befall us is that they are means to expiate sins. And he mentioned hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, where she asked, she said, I asked the Messenger of Allah about plagues and diseases, the ta'un. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had informed me that they are chastisements and punishments that Allah sends it forth upon whom He will. And He has made it for the true practicing believers a mercy. He made it a mercy for them. And never does a plague befall a believer, and he remains in it, patient, perseverant, and seeking a reward from Allah through that patience. And he realizes that what has befallen him did not befall him except by what Allah has written for him. Except that Allah subhanahu, Messenger of Allah say, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him the rewards like that of a martyr. Except that Allah will give him the rewards like that of a martyr. And so this is the reward that he will get. So all he has to be is patient. All he has to be is a person who has made ihtisab. He seeks out a reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and realize that this is nothing more than Allah using this as a means to expiate that individual sin. And he mentions a hadith of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the greatness of the of one's reward is based on the tremendousness and greatness of the trial that he goes through. So we understand from this hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you must be patient. For the companions understood this hadith. They sabaru, they were patient, and they sabaru, and they helped one another be patient. And that we understand that trials come in good times, like as it comes in bad times. And that the thing that raised the trials from us is turning to Allah. And then the Sheikh Hafizahullah begins to close this presentation, this lecture, with a supplication for the Ummah and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to raise from us trials and tribulations and plagues and diseases, and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to preserve us and protect us and to protect the Ummah of Muhammad. And he made dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't seize us because of our sins, but that he showers mercy and forgiveness upon us. And the Sheikh asked Allah subhanahu, it went on to make dua that, oh Allah, we put our reliance and trust upon you, and we turn to you, and we seek your help. And then he ended with sending praise and peace and blessings upon the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And he ended with saying, وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. And our last final call and propagation is that all praise is due to Allah, the Lord of that which exists. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Wa jazakumullahu khayra ya shaykhana. Wa zadakallahu ala al-khayr. Wa yufilu hayatika ala ta'atihi. Wa kathratu nashr al-ilm al-nafi'. Ameen.
آمين وإياكم آمين آمين بارك الله فيكم
آمين يعافيكم بارك الله السلام عليكم.